It's good to see you all again this morning. Thank you for joining us on our online service. Whether you're a visitor or whether you're here as a regular, we do welcome you today and hope that you will be blessed in God's presence. As you were all aware, we've entered a second lockdown time, but let's pray and hope that we'll be released from this lockdown in December. And when we do restart the church again, I will be in touch with you all to let you know which week you're allocated for the Sunday morning service. I know so many of you were blessed in the past for those two services. So many of you were blessed just being in the presence of God and in fellowship with other people. Let me encourage you though in the meantime, just to keep in touch with each other, keep calling each other, keep telephoning and keep in contact, whatever way and whatever means you have of keeping in contact with each other. Let me encourage you to do that. And then also friends, just a reminder on the Christmas hampers, if you want to give to that appeal, we're going to try and help 29 children this Christmas, friends, with Christmas food hampers. If you want to give to that, please contact Kate. I know it's difficult for you to get out at the moment. It's difficult for you to do shopping and not everything's open as it was. But if you need any help, give Kate a call. She'll help. If you want to donate money, just let her know and she'll come and collect it from you. If you want to give the money and she do the shopping, that's fine. Just contact Kate for any more details and she'll let you know, friends. Just a verse I want to read to you this morning, friends. It's in Acts 2:42, and it says, "And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayers." You know, friends, this verse we read at every council meeting that we have. If we have one council meeting a month, we read it. If we have one council meeting every 2 weeks, we read it. We read this verse every council meeting, friends. And today, more than ever, we need to continue in the things like fellowship, friends. You know, our fellowship has changed, hasn't it, over this last year? You know, our fellowship can be telephone calls, as I said to you earlier. Keep in touch. You can have fellowship with each other on the telephone. It can be Skype. It can be Zoom. You know, we go to the Zoom prayer meeting each week. You know, it's fellowship, and it's different to what it used to be. But you know, our fellowship hasn't changed with the Lord. You know, that stayed the same. He's always there with us at all times. We can just communicate. We can talk to him. We can pray to him at all times. We can just talk to the Lord. You know, our fellowship with the Lord has not changed. Right throughout this epidemic, our fellowship with the Lord has always remained the same. It also says we continue in breaking of bread. You know, it doesn't change, friends. We can still do that. We do it in a different way. We do it online. We do it maybe at church on the odd occasion, but you know, we break bread and we can still do that, whether it's at home, whether it's at church, wherever we are, we can still break bread, friends. We continue in breaking of bread. And then it says, and we continue in prayer. You know, let me encourage you to never let your prayer life stop. Keep praying to the Lord. Pray for others, pray for the church, pray for yourself, friends. There's nothing wrong with praying for yourself. Pray that God will pour out his blessing upon your own life and that it will keep you strong, especially at this time. You know, you can lift your heart and your voice to the Lord right where you are this day. So let's continue, friends. Let's just continue in those three main things, in fellowship, in breaking of bread, and in prayer. You know, that will keep us strong as God's people, friends. That's just all I want to leave you this morning at this point. You know, we're going to have something for the children now, and then we're going to have a worship song, and then the Word of God. And I'll be back later to speak to you before we close, friends. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Today, I just want to ask you a question. Is God your best friend? I want you to think about your very best friend, either at school or at home or wherever you have your friends. I want you to picture your best friend, have their face in your mind, and just think about what makes them your best friend. What is it that makes them your best friend? Is it because you speak to them most days or see them most days? Is it because they're nice to you and they help you when you need it? Is it because they always want to be with you or sit next to you or play with you and that makes you feel really good? Is it because you know you can tell them things and you won't be scared of what they'll say? All these things help us make a best friend and help make a best friend. either in our classrooms or in our schools or in our social lives, wherever it might be, all these things help to make the best friend. You know, in your life, you have lots of different people, and in your circle of people that you know, there are those people that you probably know their names, but you don't really know much about them, and you can't really say that they're your friends. And then there are other people that you can say, yep, they're my friends, I know who they are, I speak to them and we talk and we sometimes play together. And then there is the one person or a few people that are your best friends, your closest friends, and you know what they like, you know what their favourite food is, you know what their favourite thing to do is, you can tell when they're not feeling very happy, you know how to make them feel happy and to cheer them up, and loads of other things that you know about them. And that is how we know that that person or those people are our best friends, because we have taken the time to get to know them, and we keep getting to know them by spending lots of time with them, and we are excited when we see them and when we get to spend time with them. And that is who God wants to be in our lives. He wants to be that best friend that you speak to every day and you're excited to spend time with him. He wants to help you like a best friend whenever you ask him to, and he wants to bless you, and that means doing good things for you and give you good things as well. He wants to be that somebody, that best friend, that if something really good has happened, or if something really bad has happened, or if you've just did something quite normal, that he is the person you think, I really want to tell God about this. He wants to be that person that you tell everything to. And you might think to yourself, I can't tell God about that time when I got into trouble at school, or that bad thing that I did when nobody was looking, or that thing that no one knows that's going on inside me that's really worrying me. But you can. You can tell God everything, because he knows it anyway. He's not just sat on his big chair up in heaven with his arms crossed, tutting away, thinking, I can't believe she did that again, or they did that again. He wants you to tell him because he loves you, and he knows when you've admitted to something that you've done wrong, or you share something that's going on inside you, it makes you feel better on the inside. And he doesn't want us ever to feel bad on the inside. He wants to help us to feel better. You know, he won't get angry and he won't make fun of us, but he will love us, and he always knows what to do to cheer us up. Now, here on earth, it is easier for us to make best friends with people that we can see face to face and that we can hear with our ears. And we know that they're listening because they're looking to us, they're looking at us, and they're stood right in front of us, and they talk back to us with real words. And it might seem quite hard for us to think about getting to know God as a best friend, because we can't see him and with our eyes, and we can't hear him most of the time with our ears. Some people do, but not always. But that is when we need to use something that the Bible calls faith, and it's a very special tool that God gives us to use when we say we want to be his best friend, when we say we want to follow him. And faith is when we believe with our whole heart in something, or that someone is there even though we can't see them. So when you talk to God or tell him about your day, or ask him a question, or tell him you're upset about something, have faith and believe he is listening to you, and that he can answer your question, or that he really does care about that thing that happened to you today. And here is what will happen. In the Bible, in Hebrews 11 verse 6, it says, without faith, no one can please God. That's how important faith is. It's a really important thing. And then it goes on to say, whoever comes to God must believe that he is real, and that he rewards those who sincerely try to find him. That last bit of the verse means that God is good, does good things for those who really, on the inside, mean what they say to God. And even if they don't feel him, or feel him answer the question, or feel him around them, that they keep trying to get to know him, and they keep talking to him and spend time with him. And then he will do the good things for us. He will reward those who sincerely try to find him. So this week I have another little challenge for you. I want you to try and become best friends with God. actually think of a time in your day where you can use that time every single day to spend a little time getting to know God. Talk to him, read about him in the Bible, or just being still and just thinking about how amazing he is and what he's done. You know, sometimes our friends here on earth can let us down, and maybe they can do something that we don't like or that hurt us, and that is all because we are human and none of us are the perfect friend. But you know who is the perfect friend? God. He never lets us down, and when he says something, you can 100% be sure he will do it. He is always there for us, and he will always be our bestest friend. Thank you all for joining me this morning, and I'll see you next week.
My rock in times of trouble. Your love is the anchor. My hope is in you alone.
Well, thank you, David, and thank you, Kate, for introducing the service to us. And I want to extend a warm welcome to all those of you who are visiting our online service this morning, both church members and visitors alike. I trust you enjoy our time as we come round God's Word this morning. Jacob is a famous Bible character, and you may be aware that Jacob had something of a deceitful streak. As a younger person, he knew that his older brother was due to receive his father's blessing. And so, under his mother's advice, he deceived his dad, who was actually going blind, into thinking that he was his older brother Esau, to steal his brother's blessing. Now, the problem wasn't that Jacob was blessed. You know, God had promised that he was going to bless Jacob. And in fact, that's exactly what happened throughout Jacob's life. As he got older, God blessed him with a large family. He gave him much wealth. God gave him many good things throughout his life. The problem was how he went about getting his blessing. He was very deceitful. He was very manipulative in how he went about trying to accomplish his older brother's blessing. In fact, he stole it from him by lying to his dad, as I mentioned earlier on. And as a result of that, throughout the rest of Jacob's life, he experienced pain. He went through a series of painful experiences where, even though he was blessed, God had to knock out those old deceitful ways in him. As he had deceived his father and basically stabbed his brother in the back, so he himself was deceived and cheated by his father-in-law, Laban. He worked 14 years for his two wives, Rachel and Leah, if you're familiar with the story in the book of Genesis. And then for the 7 years, he had to work for his wages, which were changed 10 times. And so he was also got a raw end of the deal as he had dished out to others. Not only that, he also experienced personal pain in his own family. On one occasion, his son dishonored his marriage bed. And then his daughter was raped. And then also two of his sons committed murder. And then to top it all off, his favorite son, Joseph, he thought had been killed by an animal when he was delivering a message to his older brothers. And so Jacob's life was marked by pain. And not only that, he also lived under the fear of being attacked by his older brother, who would seek to revenge him for how he treated his older brother earlier on in his life. Jacob's life was marked with pain. But what you'll find is, you read the book of Genesis, Jacob started off as a deceitful man, but by the end of Genesis, he finished off a broken man. And as a result of that, actually became much more closer and connected to God. You know, when I look back over my life, I've discovered that the most important lessons I've learned weren't in the classroom, weren't from listening to a mentor in my life, weren't from what I watch on TV. The most important lessons I've learned in life have been through my pain. I think that's true for all of us. Pain has a way of drawing us closer to God if we respond to it rightly. I recently heard of a story of a man who found a bird that was being attacked by his cat. And the cat was just about to put its claws into the bird, and he rescued the bird, and he noticed the bird's wing was broken, and he cared for it, he nurtured it in his loving hands. But the bird tried to escape away from the man. And then a few weeks later, his daughter had an infection, a throat infection. He had to take her to the doctors to get an injection. And as the doctor was about to give his daughter an injection,
his daughter was crying out, "No, Daddy, no, Daddy," and she grabbed her dad and she held closely to him while the doctor gave his daughter the injection. It's interesting that, like Jacob's pain and like the young girl's pain, pain in our life should not push us away from God like that bird trying to get away from that man, but actually pain in our life should draw us closer to God. It was the author C.S. Lewis who, in writing in his book, The Problem of Pain, famously said this, that God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks to us in our conscience, but shouts to us in our pains. It is his megaphone to arouse a deaf world. You know, I believe that the most important lessons that we learn in life are through a pain. You think of all that's going on in the world today, global pandemic. Maybe this is God's way sometimes of getting our attention in our world. As you are aware, we've been doing a series of teaching titled Becoming God's Showpiece, where from the life of Job, we've been looking at some ingredients that we need to build into a lion's to become great men and women of God. We've seen that last week that our medal in life is to become his medal, that God desires to show us off as a showpiece of his grace to the angels. That we said that integrity is the only thing that we have and that can't be taken from us. That a healing response to our pain is found by being honest while respectful to God. That God is faithful to us in our trials. That we have a heavenly advocate who's greater than our spiritual accuser. And we've also seen that the measure of a great person is not in the depth of their achievements, but in the depth of their love for God. But this morning, what I want us to look at is how can we find strength in our pain? How can we find solace in our pain? Well, after the Lord has given Satan permission to go and afflict Job, we read in Job chapter 2, verses 7 to 10, these words. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and afflicted Job with painful sores from the soles of his feet to the crown of his head. And then Job took a piece of broken pottery and he scraped himself as he sat among the ashes. His wife said to him, "Are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die." And he replied, "You are talking like a foolish woman. Shall we accept good from God and not trouble?" And in all this, Job did not sin in what he said. So Job experienced a baptism of pain, of unimaginable physical torment. And the anguish of his body, he was covered with these painful sores, bear with me, these painful sores that was only compounded by the rejection that he was experiencing from his soulmate. Job experienced both physical and emotional pain. Now, if you've ever gone through physical pain, and I'm sure we've all have at various points, some people have experienced it more in their life than others. But if you've ever been through physical pain, you'll know that it doesn't just affect your body. Continuous physical pain also affects your mind, your emotions, it affects your decisions, it affects your social life. Sometimes it leads to the pain of being misunderstood, not known by those closest to us. Feelings of loneliness. It's even more painful than when we have our trust in God undermined by those closest to us, let alone the emotional and the physical turmoil of the loss. And yet I believe that more than anything else, pain has a way of drawing us closer to God. Job's life demonstrates that the physical sufferings that we face, no matter how bad they can seem, even the emotional sufferings, God can draw us closer to Him through them. So how then can we find solace, strength in our pain? I want us to look at three things that we could practically do. First thing, distract your pain. Distract your pain, if you can, in a positive way. You and I all have a pain threshold. There's only so much pain that you can take. You know, sometimes the pain that you go through can actually cause you to behave and act in negative ways. This is precisely what happened to Job. When we read in the text in verse 8 that Job took a broken piece of pottery and he scraped himself as he sat among the ashes. Job's self-harm reveals that he wasn't just feeling the rejection of his soulmate, the one who was closest to him, but also he was self-rejecting. He was rejecting himself. It's almost as if the scraping of himself was a way of distracting from the real pain that he was feeling on the inside. Maybe he had come to the point where he hated his life. He had lost his wealth, his family, and now his health. Somehow I think his self-harming was a way of relieving the suffering that he was feeling. And sometimes your life can become so painful, so miserable, that you come to the point where literally you feel like you no longer care. For some people, to self-harm is a comfort to distract from the real suffering and pain that is going on in their lives. At other times, the pain of life could be so real and so intense that it numbs them. And people self-harm so they can feel that they're alive. Maybe this is why Job was scraping himself with pieces of broken pottery. We don't know, but maybe. I want to say to you this morning that if this is something that you are experiencing, can I suggest, rather than distract yourself negatively, find positive ways to distract yourself in your pain in a way that actually draws you close to God. You know, most of the Psalms in the Bible are actually Psalms of lament. And for example, Psalm 38, David cries out to God about his physical pain. He says that there's no soundness in his bones. His wounds were festering and loathsome. His heart was pounding. His strength was failing. His back was filled with searing pain. Pain was ever with him. So what did David do in his pain? Well, we read he cried out to God. In fact, we read in verse 21, he says that, "Lord, do not forsake me. Do not be far from me. My God, come quickly to help me, my Lord, my God, and my Savior." I mean, he just lists a whole catalog of things that are just wrong in his life. He pours out his complaint to God. He says, "God, this is what is wrong." And he cries out to God. He distracted himself in a positive way. He shifted his focus from his pain onto the Lord. You know, the Bible says that if you are sick, ask for someone to pray for you. If you're in trouble, the Bible says, pray. If you want to find solace in your pain, distract your pain, not negatively, but in a positive way that draws you closer to God. Secondly, way that we can find solace in our pain is keep faith in your pain. Though as if it seems that God is nowhere to be seen, still remember that He is present and that He is good. You see, to add to Job's distress, not only does he lose his health, but the one closest to him incites him to abandon the one thing that is most precious to him. His wife said to him, "Are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die." Now, it's important to realize, before we go too heavy on his wife, that Job isn't the only person who's lost something here. His wife has as well. Job's wife has lost her children. Job's wife has lost her livelihood as well. She is in pain, as well as Job. But without realizing it, she is speaking the words of the accuser, because she can't understand, why is God allowing this to happen in our lives? See, rather than seeing everything in her life as a gift of the grace of God, she sadly had actually a religious mindset where she believed that God's favor is earned. Again, there's a pun in the Hebrew language, because in the Hebrew language, she doesn't actually say curse God and die. She actually says bless God and die. But very clearly, she was saying it sarcastically. Bless God and die. Job was effectively being ridiculed for his faith by his wife. I want to encourage you that if the pain that you are experiencing is to draw you closer to God, keep faith in it. The pain that you are experiencing is not part of God's perfect will for you, but it is in his permissible will. He is allowing it to come into your life to draw you closer to himself. And if those closest to you right now are disregarding your faith because of hardship, be it in sarcasm or ridicule or absence of love, remember, God is ever present and God is good. See, when Job responds to his wife, "You are talking like a foolish woman." The word for foolish here literally means miser. Now, misers have an entitlement attitude. There's a story in the Bible of a man by the name of Nabal. And that Nabal, his name literally means miser or fool. And Nabal refused to recognize the generosity of David when it was shown him. And as I mentioned, his name literally means miser. And the same word is used here to describe the fool who says in his heart in Psalm 14, "There is no God." Sadly, because Job's wife did not understand God's grace, she was quick to abandon God when God did not turn up for her the way that she expected God would or should. See, foolishness in our hearts, in a person's heart, cultivates an entitlement attitude where a person feels that good is owed them, that they deserve good. But Job, he did not disregard the sacred in his pain. Later, Job said that though he slay me, yet will I hope in him. He didn't have that entitlement attitude. He realized that everything that he had in life was of the grace of God. God does allow suffering, and yet in the midst of it, you can still believe in his goodness and learn to trust him. And so to find solace in your pain, distract your pain positively. Keep faith in your pain. But finally, I want to say this, be candid in your pain. With a deep sense of the sovereignty of God and trust in God, even though God was allowing this evil to come into his life, for no apparent reason, Job still says to his wife, "Shall we accept good from God and not trouble?" And these words expose a false underlying assumption that many people have about God. And that is that our human nature suggests that we are always ready to receive good things from God We always want to get the blessings from God, but somehow when it comes to trouble, we're not prepared to accept that from God. After all, who in the right mind would want to ask God for pain? None of us wants to, okay? And yet I would suggest that in our pain, the only way that we can find redemption in it is to accept it from God. I recently came across the story of a pastor of a large church in Canada who every Sunday after the message, after the meeting, he will always make a beeline for a lady who was in her 40s in a wheelchair. And all her life, she has been an invalid. Since her childhood, she's had to be cared for. She has to be cleaned by carers, fed for by carers. Her body is in constant pain. Due to her condition, she will never marry. And she will never have children. And if anyone has a right to feel angry at God for a life that has been robbed, it would be this woman. And yet every Sunday, she faithfully attends church. And as this pastor is making his way to say hello to this woman, and all, you know, the people are trying to grab his ear and they're complaining about their lives and what's going on and all the issues they're having to deal with. And when he greets this woman, he asks her, "How are you doing?" And her response is this, "Praying for you, Pastor. Still loving Jesus." Your suffering will either make you into a bitter person or a better person. And if you are to use your pain to draw you closer to God, be honest to God about your suffering while still choosing to worship God. Accept that God is still in control, that God is sovereign. And I believe that in doing so, that will prevent you from becoming a bitter person. Spiritual maturity is about being honest with God while at the same time still choosing to bless Him and trust Him. That's why the writer says in the book of Job that in all of this, Job did not sin in what he said. Even though Job was holding God ultimately responsible, he was also learning to trust God, and in doing so, was not charging God with wrongdoing. Job could so easily have missed the mark with his lips. He could have so easily have failed to bless God, but instead he chose to be honest with God about his sovereignty while still choosing to bless Him. Pain has a way of drawing us closer to God if we respond to it the right way. And so I'm going to encourage you, if you're going through real pain right now at this moment, distract it in a positive way. Keep faith in it. Be candid to God about it. None of us likes pain. And none of us would choose to have it. But you know, as long as we live in a world where there's sin and famine and diseases and earthquakes and conflict in this world, there's always going to be pain. You know, in this world where we see so much evil, people will often ask, where is God in the midst of the pain? Where is God when a child dies of malaria? Where is God when we see all the destruction in this world? But I want to say to us today that if you take the word evil and you spell it the other way around, you get live, L-I-V-E. And when we look at the life of Jesus, we see that the life of Jesus reverses the evil that we see in this world. He brings life where there's death, comfort where there's abandonment, wholeness of mind where there's distress, healing where there is sickness. In fact, it was said of Jesus that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how He went around doing good, healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with Him. him. Every time he healed people, Jesus was giving them a foretaste of what it's like in the kingdom of heaven, in the kingdom of God, in the world to come, where there will be no evil or suffering in this world. I am glad that a day will come when all the brokenness and all the evil that we see in our world will come to an end. It will, one day. But dealing with the pain of this world requires a deep work that goes to the root of the problem. And like Jacob, we all have a deceitful streak in our hearts. There's a little bit of evil in our hearts. In fact, the root of the problem, the heart of the issue, is the issue of the heart. That's why we see so much suffering, a lot of suffering in the world today. And that is why God sent us his son Jesus. You see, as a sinless and innocent man, he died a criminal's death. He took upon himself our sin, our guilt, our shame. He took upon himself the fallout of our evil to pave a way into a world where there's no more pain and no more suffering. And that's why the first step for all of us here this morning, listening to this message, to find solace in our pain is to reject deceit out of our hearts, to reject evil out of our hearts, to put our ongoing and continued trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, to get immersed in water in his name, if you haven't already done so, and to receive of his Holy Spirit. And though we will not live a pain-free life this side of eternity, we will find a way that it can be used for us to draw us close to God as we learn to trust in him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you have not promised us a pain-free life in this world. I pray that, Father God, that you will help us and guide us and direct us, Lord God, so that when we do experience pain, when it does come into our hearts and lives, that rather than us becoming bitter people, that we become better people. Rather than it causing us to push us away from you, let it cause us to draw us closer to you. So God, I pray that as we learn to distract it in whatever way we can, to keep faith in it, to be candid about it, Lord, before you, I pray that, Lord, that you will bring us nearer to you. In Jesus' name, amen. If this morning you have not yet come to that point, a place of offering your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, of taking that first step of faith and coming into his kingdom, I'm going to pray this prayer. And as I pray this prayer, I'm going to ask you to repeat these words after me in your heart. Lord Jesus Christ, I'm sorry for the things I've done wrong in my life. Please forgive me. I now turn from all that I know is wrong. Thank you that you died on the cross for me so that I can be forgiven and set free. Thank you that you offer me forgiveness and the gift of your Spirit. I now receive that gift. Please come into my life and live with me by your Spirit forever. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, thank you for listening to this message. And you've prayed that prayer for the first time, please drop me an email at info@mpconline.org and I'll drop you an email, give you some details and point you in the right direction. We're going to come round breaking of bread, but just before we do so, we're just going to have a short time of worship. See you soon.
And wars to own.
Before we do so, I want to read to you a few verses of scripture from Paul's letter to the church of Corinth. He says that, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I'll destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For Jews request a sign and Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified. To the Jews a stumbling block and to the Greeks foolishness. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men and the weakness of God is stronger than men." You know, when we think about the message of the cross and as we come round the breaking of bread this morning, It is so counterintuitive, isn't it? Surely if God was going to come into this world and save this world, he'd come in great power and glory. And, you know, at the time of Jesus, surely Jesus rose up against the Romans and, you know, did great feats. But that's not how God chose to save this world and redeem this world. He came to do it in a way that to us seems powerless and even foolish. Who in their right mind would want to go to the cross and give up their lives? And yet that was the way that God decided to break into this world and reveal himself to us. And so for us to connect with God this morning, we need to actually let go of our own wisdom and trust in his wisdom. We need to let go of our own power and our own abilities and trust in God's power and in God's ability. Because it's really about us laying down our pride and humbly coming before the Lord to receive of his goodness and of his grace. And so as we take the bread, as we take the cup, we remind ourselves of the sacrifice of the Lord for us. Let's take of the bread. Let's take of the cup as well. Lord, we thank you that both your wisdom and your power is demonstrated at the cross. And Lord, I ask and pray that you will help us to learn from you. Help us to rely on your wisdom and your power ahead of our understanding and our ability. Grow us to become ever more like you in Christ's likeness of character. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And just before we go, I just want to just pray for those in the church who are grieving the loss of loved ones, and for those who are sick. I just pray, Father, Lord, that you will be the God of comfort right now to those who are who've lost loved ones recently, and that, God, that you will strengthen them and be with them at this time. And for those right now who are sick in body, that you'll place your healing hand of health upon them, Lord. And some people who have been affected with the virus, Lord, the COVID virus, I just pray your healing hand and strength upon them at this time. Preserve us, keep us, strengthen us as a church. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. Well, thank you, and I'm going to hand over to David, who's going to close the service for us. Thank you.
Well, welcome back, and thank you for that word, and thank you for the breaking of bread. Just a few notices before we close our service this morning. Just one thing to remember: on Tuesday at 6:45, is the Bible teaching, and that can be found on YouTube or through the website mpconline.org. Tuesday at 7:30 is a Zoom prayer meeting, and let me encourage you, if you can join us, then do join us to pray for the needs in our community, for the needs in the church, for all the needs that we can remember at this time. Let's spend this time in prayer. So if you need the details for the Zoom prayer meeting, please contact Matthew and he will let you have those details. And let me just encourage you to keep praying, friends. Next Sunday morning we have our online service at 10:45 a.m. Please continue to join us if you can. Please spread the word and let others know, you know, just by clicking on the button and joining us, you can be blessed in God's presence through the internet. A final reminder, friends, for the Christmas food hamper. If you've got anything you want to donate to that, please let Kate know. Please contact us if you would like to give to this. You know, I said a couple of weeks ago, didn't I, that there's 11 different families that we want to help this Christmas. 11 different families in the community around the church, local families, friends, with those 29 children. You know, at Christmas it's going to be so strange, so different this year. We don't know what it's going to be like yet. But you know, friends, we can still show the love of Jesus to the community in Mansfield. We can still show what Christmas is really about. It is about gifts. It's the gift of Jesus coming into this world. It's a gift of the love of God. And we want to show that love of God to the families. So if you want to give to this appeal, please contact Kate and just let her know what you want to do, and she'll just be so happy for your call. Thank you again for joining us this morning, friends. Thank you for joining us on this online service. I pray that God will bless you this week, that he'll pour out your blessing upon his blessing upon your lives, and that you will just be in his presence throughout this week. Join us again throughout the week and at next Sunday morning or so, friends. Thank you all for joining us. God bless you all. Thank you.
Your love, your love. skies of mercy and rain down the cleansing flood, healing waters rise around us and hear our cries, Lord, let them rise.